For thousands upon thousands of years throughout the tall tales of human history, the final hours of our species have long been lamented upon. Will we disappear in a blaze of cosmic hellfire? Will we shuffle from this mortal coil after the choking devastation of a nuclear winter? Or will our life-giving sun decide to spit forth an earth-scorching solar flare and snuff out this brief candle that we once called humanity? Whichever form the apocalypse would take, it need not matter though, because what we're concerned with is how our planet Earth would fare after our species suddenly disappeared. So I guess we better find out. Hello internet, what's going on? And once again, welcome back to the most inquisitive channel on YouTube, Life's Biggest Questions. As per usual, I'll be your disembodied floating voice, Jack Finch, as today we curiously ask the question, what would happen to Earth after humans disappear? Roll the clip.
We're the hollow men. We're the stuffed men, leaning together, headpiece filled with straw.
For the curious amongst you, that particularly moody and atmospheric scene was, of course, of Marlon Brando's relentlessly brilliant performance in Francis Ford Coppola's legendary cinematic work, Apocalypse Now, which is quite fitting, really. And of course, Colonel Kurtz himself just so happened to be reading the equally apocalyptic poem, The Hollow Men, written by T.S. Eliot in 1925. That particular poem ends with the final lines, "This is the way the world ends, not with a bang, but a whimper," which can only mean one thing. Ah, it's the end of the world as we know it, but unfortunately we don't feel fine in this given hypothetical situation, because as you may have already been mentally alarmed by the title of this particular Life's Biggest Question, the end of civilization has sadly already occurred. However, now that we're on the subject of artists throughout the ages that have mused upon the end of humanity, we can begin our question in parentheses by addressing another contemporary comic, the legendary George Carlin, who when it comes to the end of the world has an incredibly important bit to share.
Planet isn't going anywhere. We are!
Exactly, George. Thank you. And in that particular stand-up show, Mr. Carlin outlined the fact that our fair planet Earth has been around for a little over 4.5 billion years, during which time our pale blue dot has been through so many cataclysmic catastrophes that it's earned itself quite a few stripes in the process. Solar flares, volcanoes, worldwide floods, continental forest fires, cosmic rays, millennia-long swathes of ice ages, gigantic asteroids, and that was before we even came along. At one point, our planet was literally a boiling soup of magma. It's safe to say that this wonderful place that we currently call our home is quite resilient. You see, the thing is, we're the ones that are fragile, because unlike planet Earth, we can't recover, and we've only been around for a fraction of a second compared to the vast ancestry of our planet. But as is the case in this hypothetical situation, we've tragically blown our only chance like a kid who left their homework till the last minute. But now that we're here, we may as well take a look around and see what the planet has in store now that humanity has disappeared. And the good news is that despite our towering monoliths of engineering and architecture, now that we are out of the equation, the planet would eventually become a much better place for the surviving species of the animal kingdom. Initially though, things would be a little sketchy, as those aforementioned infrastructures of industry would have a tendency to, well, kind of blow up. Within the first few days, our systems of infrastructure that require constant human control would inevitably meet their unsupervised end. Subways across the planet would begin filling with water, as the regulatory plumbing systems that keep most of them below the water table free from flooding would break down and begin to fail. Within a week, most water cooling systems in nuclear reactors would run out of fuel, setting off a chain of explosive events that would become so catastrophic that if we were still alive, then it's goodnight Vienna all over again. Not only that, but all of those satellites currently orbiting the globe, yeah, they're going to be plummeting back down to terra firma within a few days, which will only add fuel to the fire given the fact that there are approximately 4,987 currently in orbit. Watch out, because the sky is indeed falling. Drop that ass before it crash. Not only that, but the risk of a petroleum-fueled blaze of hellfire is incredibly likely. With all of the oil and gas reserves currently on our planet, all it would take is a single one of these highly likely explosive events to trigger a continental wildfire. Take a look at the Kuwaiti oil fires, for example, where over 700 oil wells were set fire to during the Persian Gulf War that blazed relentlessly from January 1991 up until November the 6th, releasing so much smoke into the sky that it resulted in a 2% annual global emissions increase of carbon dioxide on our planet. Now, imagine that on every continent. Yeah, not a pretty picture. In fact, with our demise and subsequent disappearance, without the capability of maintaining these fragile systems of energy and power, we could very well do catastrophic damage to many, many of the surviving species. And that's even without addressing the fact that there's currently 300 million tons of plastic in our oceans, and now there's no one around to clean it up. Yeah. Things are looking pretty bad. But here comes the hubris, guys, because as we said previously, Earth is a resilient planet. And although the demise of our civilization may very well cause many further catastrophic fallouts, given a long enough time, planet Earth will begin to heal. Within several years, perhaps the most successful species will be our avian friends, who, without the massive interference from electromagnetic and radio signals, would be free to populate unhindered, perhaps reaching gigantic flocks of up to 1 billion birds. Within 5 or so years, taking into account the apocalyptic devastation wrought across the planet, most buildings that weren't made from metal would likely already be crumbling, although it would take perhaps as long as 300 years for large metallic structures to begin falling down. So if any alien species did manage to pop in for a visit, at least they could find comfort in knowing that someone used to live here. There would still be clear apparent signs of our civilization for at least another 1,000 years without intervention, but at that point, who knows what type of wild and frenzied biosphere our planet Earth would have cooked up just to deal with the apocalyptic treasure trove that our species left behind. Eventually, there would be only a few specific landmarks remaining to flagpole our significance on this planet. The Channel Tunnel between England and France would likely still be there. It would just take, you know, a bit of digging to find it. The same applies to Mount Rushmore, whose presidential likeness would look a tad weathered, but still evidence of our civilization nonetheless. Perhaps even the Great Pyramids of Giza would still be standing, given the fact that they have already withstood the endless sands of time and may well serve as a reminder to the next sentient species on our planet that we, humanity, once existed. You see, George Carlin was right. Eventually, our planet will be fine. She'll need a little bit of healing and a tad recalibration. She'll probably have to endure a few more ice ages to get things back into ship shape, but planet Earth will continue to spin nonetheless. You see, it's humanity that can't withstand the end of the world. Well, there we have it, our long and short answer to the question, what would happen to Earth after humans disappear? Eventually, she'll put herself back on course and be like, whoa, those humans, eh? I tried to warn them. Well, what did you guys think? Do you agree? Have any more to add? Then let us know your thoughts down in the comment section below, as well as any intriguing insights that you'd like to share. Unfortunately, that's all we've got time for in today's video, but if you'd like to continue on with your questioning binge, then please feel free to browse through our conveniently compiled playlist for your viewing enjoyment. If you were a fan of this video, or just Life's Biggest Questions in particular, then please be a dear and hit that thumbs up button, as well as that subscribe bell, and I'll be seeing you in the next one. As per usual, I've been your disembodied floating voice, Jack Finch. You've been watching Life's Biggest Questions, and until next time.